but it's a pretty big part of the supply. And so when I talk about the CAP being in jeopardy, obviously it doesn't affect everybody to the same degree. Different cities get different amounts of CAP water. And I'm not going to go into all of them, but you can see here groundwater is important, but mostly for agriculture. In-state rivers, that's the salt in the Gila, the salt in the Verde flowing into the Gila. That's 1 million acre feet a year. It's a lot of water. And right now, they're doing very well. There's sort of a reverse situation here in Maricopa County. It seems like when Salt River's doing well, CAP does poorly, and the vice versa is also occasionally true. But that 36% from the Colorado River, it's much greater in the central part of the state. And for cities that are outside of the SRP area, it is a much greater percentage of their demand. So Phoenix, for example, is about a third. Third groundwater, third CAP, a third SRP. The mayor probably went over that about a month ago. But if you in the city of Scottsdale, I don't actually know what Paradise Valley's numbers are, but Scottsdale is almost 60% from Salt River Project, excuse me, from CAP. Tucson is 100%. All of the water coming to the city of Tucson comes from the Colorado River in terms of renewable supply. They also have groundwater, but as you know, groundwater is not a renewable resource, and it tends to be extinguished after a lot of pumping. Just a quick word, the CAP is governed by an elected board. You might not know that because in order to get to the nonpartisan race for Central Arizona Project, you literally go as far down on the ballot as you can. Below the judges, I didn't know it got lower than that. And it is, as I said, nonpartisan. We have 5 seats open this year, so there are a number of folks, including me, who are going to be running for re-election. It's a 6-year term. It has a munificent salary of 0. And so everybody's a volunteer, and there are a total of 15. 1 from Pinal County, that's our benchmark, 4 from Pima, and 10 from Maricopa. All right, let's get into the basin. This is the real heart of our story. It's the Colorado River Basin. There are 7 states that receive a significant amount of water from the Colorado River. It's a small river in terms of worldwide comparisons. The Mississippi, the Missouri, the Columbia, the Willamette are so much bigger than the Colorado. But this is a critical because it is so central to a big part of the population in the Southwest. We figure 40 million people get their supply to a significant degree from this single water source. Very significant amount of agriculture and a lot of industry. So it is, I hate to refer to a river as a plumbing exercise, but as a plumbing, the Bureau of Reclamation and the Colorado River are truly extraordinary. And it is all used, and I guess that is the bottom line. Now, it's divided between 2 basins. You see that on the map. There are 4 states in the upper basin and 3 in the lower. The 3 in the lower are Arizona, Nevada, and California. Let's talk about the history for just a minute. Back in 1922, 7 white men, and you can see most of them, let's say of mature age, got together in Santa Fe, New Mexico to divide the river. Now, a lot has changed in the 100 plus years since then. You could never put a group together right now to decide our water future that looked like this. But back in those days, that was what took place. The commission was chaired by a guy named Herbert Hoover. He was then the Secretary of Commerce. He went on to be President of the United States. He was an engineer, and he had a lot of interest in this basin from an engineering perspective. But they had a very hard time figuring out, how do we do this? How much water is in the river? And then how do we divide it among the states that so desperately need it? Now, at that time, they probably didn't need it as much as they do today. A couple of reasons for that. 1, the population hadn't come yet. 2, the river was much bigger, by their estimation, than we now know it to be today. So they divided a much bigger and more abundant supply. I'll talk a little more about that. But the main thing, as you probably know, there's in the West, there's something called the law of prior appropriation. First in time, first in right. The one who gets the use, the productive use of water first has the senior rights to that water forever. And so if you're a later user, you could conceivably be cut off by a more senior user. Well, here's what the Western states were worried about back in 1922. California was growing very rapidly. None of the rest of the states were. And they felt that without some kind of restrictions, California would take it all, that they would have the entire Colorado River supply. And so this was a defensive move on the part of the other six states to try to rein in California, who already was using more than they ultimately got through the Colorado Compact. California came to the table for one reason only, as far as I can tell, and that was the money to build the All-American Canal. They needed the infrastructure, as we do, to try to get the water to their demand, to Los Angeles, San Diego, into the Imperial Valley. But they gave up a fair amount. And the second part of this equation was these seven men were dedicated to the idea the city should, that the state should solve it themselves, that this was not appropriately the province of the federal government. You can see a little bit of these themes still playing out in today's politics. But they wanted to do it themselves. A guy named Doff Carpenter from Colorado was the leader of this effort. Arizona came along somewhat stubbornly, and we'll talk a little about that. At the very last line, the compact was issued in 1922. The other six states approved it immediately. It divided the basins with half to the upper basin, half to the lower basin. They decided it was 7.5 million acre feet was the right amount. I don't know where that came from. And then in 1944, Mexico got another 1.5 by treaty. So the total of 16 million acre feet was what they believed in those days was a reliable number that they could divide in terms of the Colorado River. You'll see in a moment, today's numbers are a little more stark. The reliable supply with climate change is around 10 to 11 million acre feet a year. So we went very quickly from an expected 20 million back in 1922 to what we're trying to divide up today. And that's part of the problem that we're trying to deal with. So that was the Colorado Compact. Arizona walked away from the table unhappy and basically said, we need it all. If the lower basin is getting 7.5, we should have the 7.5. We were very sharing in those days. And there was a senator in Maricopa County in approximately this time who led the effort to get it all. And he had something called the Highline Canal that he very seriously proposed, and he was elected over and over again on this basis. And that it was Arizona should put a dam, at least ferry, and essentially take the entire flow of the Colorado River across the Mogollon Rim, think about that for a minute, and into the Salt and the Verde watershed, because it was our river. And he had some justification. We have more Colorado River frontage in Arizona than any other state. And so he thought of it as our river, and we could do with it as we want. That was the prevailing sense, and Arizona, until 1944, refused to sign. They didn't want to take a mere 2.8 million acre feet, which was what the compact gave them. Now, when we finally agreed that, okay, we'll agree to the 2.8, Colorado getting 4.4, which was less than they actually were taking at that time, and Nevada, which barely was a rounding error in the general feeling at the time, got 300,000 acre feet, I think just as sort of chump change, they needed something. We've lived to regret that. Now, the problem for Arizona was the most we felt we could use agriculturally on the river itself was about 1 million acre feet. Well, we were entitled to 2.8, we believed, although there's a little bit of disagreement, there was from the beginning, about whether part of that 2.8 was the Gila River. As I said, the Gila is 1 million acre feet. It is an internal river to Arizona. There's a tiny bit in New Mexico, but all the rest of it is within the borders of the state of Arizona. So if it was included in the calculations, then it was about even. Arizona was getting what it was entitled to. Well, we didn't agree with that. We didn't agree with much. And so we went to court. And here you see we learned a couple of lessons. We arguably won the battle in the Supreme Court, but the case was filed in 1952, I believe. Yeah, and it was finally settled in 1964. So things that go through the Supreme Court take a lot of time, and the results are by no means certain. But we did, at the end of this litigation, get the rights to use the Gila River internally, not to be part of our allocation from the Colorado. And so that left, if you do the math, Yuma and the rest of the river counties are using about 1 million acre feet for agriculture. That left 1.8 surplus. Well, California was delighted with that situation. They took the surplus. They put it in Imperial Valley. They used it in Los Angeles. And everything was fine, except Arizona was unhappy with it. And we went to court to try to make sure we could get our rights to it, number one. And after that was done, we wanted to figure out a way to get the water into central Arizona. And that's what you see on the screen here. In 1968, the Congress passed the act which provided for the Central Arizona Project. At that time, it was only $3 billion. It grew to almost five by the time it was finished. But what I put in bold up there is the fact that little Arizona, with three congressmen, were able to get a project of that size through the Congress over the objection of both the Upper Basin and California was nothing short of a miracle. And let me just digress for a second as to why that political miracle was possible. There were a couple of people that made it possible. One is in this picture, and it's not the president. It's Carl Hayden, who at that time was arguably the most powerful man in Congress. He was president pro tem of the Senate. He was, I think at that time, the longest serving senator. He was chairman of appropriations, and he had the ear of Lyndon Johnson. In fact, Johnson was his protege. So Hayden was in an absolutely amazing position, but he had a little bit of support. There was what I would refer to as the magnificent dynamic duo of John Rhodes and Morris Udall. These were both in the House of Representatives, and they were two of the most extraordinary representatives, one from each party, that any state had at that time. Brilliant men, incredible tacticians, and it was all to benefit Arizona for passing this particular piece of legislation. There was one other, Morris's brother, who was Secretary of Interior, Stuart Udall. So here is this amazing combination. And Arizona actually plotted and schemed and worked very hard to be able to get that combination of people in the administration, in the Congress, at the time when it mattered the most. And they were able to do it. Now, there was one little glitch that will be very important to what I have to say today. In order to get past the California 40-plus Congress people and to have them sign off on something that clearly was not in their best interest, that 1.8 million acre feet was something they had their eyes on that went into the CAP. Arizona had to agree to have the lowest priority on the river for the Central Arizona Project, not for the Yuma farmers, not for the people that are currently taking water, but for the CAP, for what came into Central Arizona. We had to say, California will get its full entitlement, even if it means the CAP goes dry. That was the deal that was made by Udall and Rhodes and the rest of them. Otherwise, it would never have passed. So that was a deal with the devil, perhaps, but it was the way that this particular phenomenon got through the Congress. Now, you probably know well about these two dams. This is the regulatory portion of the river. It's the reason we have a secure supply in the three states below Lake Mead, because these rivers catch the surplus and are able to provide water in the shortage period. And they're amazing. Together, they're 50 million acre feet of storage capacity. There's nothing like it anywhere else in this continent, and I would argue in the globe. Okay, here's what happens because of the basin, and I just want to touch on this very quickly. But it's an amazingly productive area of the country. 40 million people, major cities, 30 tribes, 5 million acres of farmland. The whole Imperial Valley is entirely watered by this river. 60 million acre feet of storage capacity. Actually, they added 10 because it's in, you'll see this more in another map. It's in the upper basin that there's additional 10 million acre feet. Hydropower, very significant for both Lake Powell and Lake Mead, both produce a tremendous amount of electricity at a very low rate. And national parks, wildlife, and you know the recreational opportunities of the Grand Canyon alone are just extraordinary. But here is the key issue right now. And I use the word drought advisedly because what's happening here, and you can see from this chart, if you can see anything from this chart, is that over the past, since 1960, which is what this shows, we've had good years and we've had bad years. And the good years ended in 2000, which is the high point there. The dams on the river were at capacity, or just a fairly small amount. There's a wonderful book, just as an aside, called The Green Mile. I don't know if anybody's read it. It's about the time when Lake Powell almost overflowed. It was at such a high level, and this was about, it was in the earlier one of those high peaks. And this guy, although it was illegal, decided that he would set the record for rafting the river from Lake Powell to Lake Mead. And so he waited till midnight on a dark night and started off there at Lee's Ferry. And he, in fact, did set the record. It will never be touched by an oar's conveyance at incredible danger to his life. Okay, now look what happens in 2000. That precipitous fall was the first warning that we got that maybe things on the river weren't quite what we had been led to believe. And I'm talking about the gray, which is the combined capacity of the two lakes. And it goes down to, on the far right, is the Meuse that we're kind of living with today. We had a really great winter last year, so it was somewhat alleviated, but you can see the trend. And the trend is not a drought. We call this the millennial drought. The last time we had this much bad weather, this much aridity in this area was 1,200 years ago. So millennial indeed, a little more than millennial. But when you talk about that, a drought assumes that it's going to get better, that you're going to have rains that will help you out. And that's not what we're seeing here. What we're seeing is aridification. We're seeing the temperature in the Rocky Mountain forests is going up, and the land is drier. So the result is the amount of water getting into Lake Powell, which is our watershed, is much less, even in a year of normal rainfall and normal snowfall. But that's not what we've been getting. Here is the inflow to Lake Powell. And you can see this last year is pretty high. But look at the three years before that. Don't ignore the, for the moment, that's the current years, the ones that are in color. So look at the blue. 2023 was a wonderful year. We're not expecting quite as good a year. The green, the middle bar, is the most probable input on the river this year. That big high one, forget it. That's the 10% least likely opportunity. So I shouldn't even be on this graph. But you see, it's wildly erratic, but it is trending down. And that's what we're dealing with now. This is how good last year was. You can see the change in Lake Mead was dramatic, from minus 18 to plus 20. Lake Powell was about the same percentage-wise. But one swallow does not make a spring, and one good season, unfortunately, doesn't end the drought. This is a thing that Central Arizona Project Board gets every month, and it's generally a pretty depressing story. We call it the bucket chart, and it basically shows you all the reservoirs in the Colorado Basin. And you can see, even with the great year, and with Lake Powell filling up like a bathtub and with the water on full, it still is at less than half of capacity. And it is, well less than half. The capacity of Mead is 26. Right now it's at 8. And the capacity of Powell is 23. Right now it's at 8. And so those buckets are telling you the story of what we're dealing with right now. And the other more full lakes are the small ones, mostly in Colorado, that feed into the Colorado system. I don't expect anybody to read or memorize this chart, but I want you to know what it stands for. Back in the 2000s, you saw that precipitous fall in terms of the lake levels. And so even the federal government figured out this was a problem. And so the states got together, and in 2007, they came up with a new arrangement for how they would govern the river in a time of shortage, because it looked like the shortage was on us. And it involved the states giving back part of the water they were using. But I say states advisedly, because if you look deep into that chart, the tier one, which is the first of the cutbacks, mostly impacts Central Arizona. Almost all of the cuts called for in tier one came off of the Central Arizona Project. Why is that? Because of the agreement that was made in Congress in 1968, the agreement that California would take first precedent and we would be last. So we agreed, we followed through on that. So the CAP went in the 2022, you see the line is highlighted there, and I've got a better, there's another description of what happened. We had a tier one shortage, and what that meant was out of a 1.5 million acre feet flow, the CAP went down 500,000. So one third of the total amount of water being delivered to Central Arizona was taken away. Now last year was somewhat better. So that's why now we dip down to what we called a 2A shortage and then back up to a tier one. I hate to keep using those names. I know they don't mean anything, but what it meant to us was 500,000 acre feet, one third of our total capacity was not coming anymore. Now, what did that mean? Nothing to the cities, nothing to the tribes, but it meant that Pinal County agriculture basically went away. They were the lowest priority on our system, and they took the significant amount of the heat. This is just a sidelight, and during this period, we knew there was trouble. So the state started saving water in Lake Mead. Arizona saved 512,000 acre feet, not because we were so generous, but because that was the agreement that had been made back in 2007. But the other states put in water, sometimes voluntarily and sometimes with compensation. And here is the total savings since 2014. And you can say it's a lot. In fact, Lake Mead and Lake Powell would be very close to dry right now if this hadn't been going on over the past several years. Now, the big bonus was in this last couple of years when the Department of Interior, the Bureau of Reclamation, started paying people to put water in Lake Mead. And they did, and it has made a tremendous difference. But that's not gonna go on forever. Okay, the 2007 guidelines got us started by managing the two lakes. And now we're in the crisis mode, and this is what I hope you will take away from this talk, is we're having to redo the 2007 guidelines. And it's an entirely different environment. It's an environment of scarcity. It's an environment where Arizona, Central Arizona, has the lowest priority. And there is serious talk about running the CAP to zero. Now, I personally believe that will never happen, but as part of a negotiation, there are folks in the basin, other states, Colorado leading the pack, that basically say, well, why should you have any water? You're wasting it. You've got 200 golf courses in Maricopa County alone. My apologies to any golfers, but frankly, you're part of the problem. Fountain Hills is blowing the water up into the air, and I believe it never comes down again. So that's another part of the problem. We're not particularly good at public relations when it comes to water. And in fact, Central Arizona could do a much better job. So what do we have to do in the next couple of years leading up to a new agreement among the states? We're fighting for our life. I think that's very real. That's not an exaggeration. And we need to recognize the new normal. And here's a startling concept, but I think it's one that we have to insist on. And that is the states need to equally share the burden of the shortages. And by this, I mean something that is not agreed on in the Colorado Compact, hasn't even been discussed. But 1.5 million acre feet are the result of evaporation and system loss. In other words, canals lose water. That's just the nature of canals. They evaporate water. That's the nature of canals. And lakes. And that 1.5 million acre feet has all come out of the hide of California and Arizona. That's not fair. And so there's some rejiggering of this equation that has to be taken into account. So what's next? Where do we go? Well, there's one future. Everybody's seen Dune. They have water rebreathers, if you haven't seen Dune, so that you don't lose any body liquid. I don't think so, but we do have a lot of things we have to think about very seriously, especially here in Southern Arizona, in Central Arizona. Augmentation, a lot of talk about that. Desal in Mexico and so on. I frankly think that's the last on the list of possibilities. Conservation, yes, very important, and we need to have a new ethic about how we use water. Reuse, cities led by Phoenix are talking about very seriously changing. I hate the word toilet to tap, but that's basically what we're talking about, because we can purify the water to a drinking water standard. And there's a lot of talk for golf courses and others about, well, they use reclaimed water. That's all treated sewage. Well, there's no such thing anymore because it's all water. It all can be used, and it all has to be considered part of our resource. And the last part is recovery, which is, and this is part of the reason we're in a little trouble right now. While Arizona's CAP was bringing 1.5 million acre feet into the central part of the state, the cities and the farms couldn't use it all. What did they do? Well, I think they did what any miser would do. They put it underground. And so there's almost 12 million acre feet of water that has been conserved and put in the ground. Now, there's a problem with that. We put it in the ground without thinking how we were going to get it back out. And now that's where the reclamation comes in. We're going to have to put pumps in ground. We're going to have to move the water where it is today to the canals so that it can be distributed and used. But those are the major areas of possibility. I bring this in now because I think it would have been wasted if I'd shown this slide at the beginning of the presentation. But I hope nobody misses the fact that who has 72% of the total water supply? And as long as that's true, it's unclear to me that we have an emergent crisis. We have a manageable crisis. But it means bringing the agricultural interests and the cities together, and this hasn't happened yet, and basically having a very realistic talk about the future of our state and our economy. Because the water is there, but it's in other pockets. And so if you want to grow alfalfa, you pretty much have an open invitation to do it. But if you want to expand a factory, or you want to bring in new residential housing, you have to prove a 100-year supply. And I think the latter is appropriate, and we've done very good water management in that groundwater use, but it's not fair. And so when we talk about things like desalt, you really have to think about, that's $3,000 an acre foot. There probably is some surplus farm activity or some martyr line farming, which would be satisfied with a payment of far less than that. But right now, the discussions haven't gone forward. And so this is a chart for realism. This is what we have. But it's also a reflection on our political reality, which is we haven't even tried yet to make sure that this use of water actually corresponds to the economic and individual needs. More information? Believe it or not, I haven't covered everything. And so I would hope that you would go to any of these. Know Your Water News is the CAP website. Has a lot of good information, most of the slides that I've just used. The CIP.com, Arizona Department of Water Resources, who is the major spokes entity and advocacy entity for the state of Arizona, has a great website, and so does the Department of Bureau of Reclamation. So these are things that hopefully you will look at for additional information. And whoops, go this way, and thank you. So I would love to have questions if anybody, and I suspect knowing many in this crowd that you will have questions. And you have to talk into the microphone because they, although they're not broadcasting this show, apparently it is being recorded. So unless you talk into the mic, nobody listening to the recording will know what you said.
Okay, how's that? My question is regarding desalination. Is it because of the cost that you think that would be our last alternative?
That's a pretty good reason. But it is also somewhat impractical. Let me try to paint the picture. The only way in central Arizona we're going to get the water from a Gulf of Baja California desal plant is, first, we got to get permission from the Mexican government. They are not supportive. They might be in the future, but at this moment, there has been no agreement by Mexico to allow this to happen. Northern Baja California, the northern bay of the Gulf of Baja California is a very sensitive environment. And to put huge amounts of additional salt into that water, I don't know what the repercussions would be, but we're going to have to know. So there's two problems. It's international. We're having a terrible time doing interstate discussions. Once you get international, you've got a whole level of additional complexity. We have Mexico has been a good partner on the Colorado River. They have participated through over 300 minute entries after the 1948 agreement to share in the Colorado River. They've taken the hits when there was shortage, and they've stepped up. So I have very few complaints about the Mexican participation. The tragedy is the Colorado doesn't get to the Gulf of California anymore. There is a whole environmental catastrophe going on in that area that used to be the Delta. But the bottom line is, it's a $5 to $10 billion project just to get it off the ground. It only produces 200,000 acre feet, so our shortage is in the millions, so it's not going to do it. And it costs at least, and this is based on the San Diego experience and the Israel experience, close to $3,000 an acre foot to have salt water treated. And we have other resources, not just agriculture, as I put on the board, which is, they use Colorado River water, which is the purest water around, doesn't need to be treated. But Western Maricopa County has big reserves of brackish water, which are not drinkable and they are not suitable for crops, but they are much easier to treat than seawater. So we have some resources here domestically that could, and I think should be, our first line of attack. So keep the saltwater panacea in your mind. It helps to establish the market, if nothing else. But I don't think it's practical.
Okay, thanks.
So anybody who's driven in Southeast Arizona is aware of these mega farms, some of them owned by Saudi Arabia. So I know that our Attorney General and our governor are addressing that. Can you give us an update with what's going on?
Well, isn't it interesting that it's illegal to grow alfalfa in the country of Saudi Arabia? Why is that? So whose water gets used to feed the cows in Saudi Arabia? Ours. And that is an irony of global proportions. But it's not easy to solve because, you know, the governor stepped up and canceled some leases, and she had that right because they were public lands that were being farmed. She's going to have to pay a lot because under those leases, the Saudi companies have the right to any improvements that they made, and there's millions of dollars of improvements that they're going to claim. So it's a difficult, but I think they took the right issue. But if they do that and don't reform the groundwater code in Arizona, they will have wasted the effort. Because the Saudis are by no means the only ones using groundwater in Arizona. You probably know this, but the groundwater management code that was passed by Bruce Babbitt and a more compliant legislature back in 1980 only applies, the AMAs, the active management areas, are only in Maricopa, Pinal and Pima counties, with a little bit in Yavapai County. The rest of the state is, pardon the expression, the Wild West. There are no restrictions. You can get all the water you can pump for free. There's no cost for that water, and there is no obligation to report what you're using. So, excuse me, we're living in a fool's paradise if that allowed to continue. And there's a lot of opposition in the legislature right now to having AMAs expanded statewide. But frankly, I think that's responsible management. We did a great job when we started. The whole idea of the 100-year supply and the zero depletion, which was the goal of the 1980 Groundwater Management Act, was commendable. And it is something we could be very proud of. But the fact that there are an awful lot of counties and a lot of very active areas now with growth that don't have similar restrictions is simply foolish. And as Arizonans, we need to focus on that, and I think we need to fix it. Now, it may not be quite as aggressive as the AMAs are because they were the first, and arguably we had to do that, or something called the Central Arizona Project never would have been authorized. You probably know the story, but I think it's worth repeating. Cecil Andress was the Secretary of Interior. The act had already been passed in 1968, but in 1972, 73, he met with then-Governor Babbitt, and they... they talked about, okay, what can we do to make sure that this water is used wisely? And Andrus said very clearly, well, we're not going to use it if it just fuels a lot more irresponsible growth and depletion of the groundwater supply. In other words, the water needs to come into a stable environment if we're going to pay all this money to build the CAP. And so Arizona passing the groundwater code was part of that elaborate bargain that came to having this piece of plumbing come into our backyard. I'm sorry he agreed to do it just in the metropolitan areas. That probably was, in historic terms, a mistake. But that was the deal that was made in those days.
In December, two tribe leaders from Arizona were named Arizonans of the Year, partly because of their involvement in water. It was the Colorado Indian Tribe and then the Gila. The Gila gets 360 acre-feet of water per year, and then the Colorado gets 650-something thousand acre-feet of water. They were named partly because they were able to get the federal government right to say you can lease your water. So, one, why weren't they able to lease it before, and who is it going to benefit now to help with some shortages?
We got another hour. it was very appropriate. I mean, Chairwoman Flores of the Colorado Indian Tribes and Governor Stephen Rowe Lewis of the Gila River Indian Community have been water leaders in Arizona. A lot of the work in terms of putting some of our water back in Lake Mead to try to mitigate the crisis came from their supplies. And so it was a good recognition. It was entirely for their water leadership that they were recognized. Right now, the number one client of the Central Arizona Project after the cutbacks is the Gila River Indian Community. They have, in various ways, and they get water from several different sources. They have about 600,000 acre-feet of water that they could have access to. It's not quite half of the CAP deliveries today with the cutbacks. And so I'm wrong about the 600. It must be lower than that because we're only delivering 1 million acre-feet now. But it is a huge water. They're the OPEC, let's be very clear, of Central Arizona, because water supplies will, for a great degree, and City of Phoenix and Mesa and I think Chandler have already long-term contracts with GRIC to basically share in their amounts. And it's, believe it or not, I think it's more lucrative to them right now in cash-wise than the casinos, and that's saying something. So it's an important part of our water picture. CRIT is different because all of the GRIC water comes from the CAP. So they have exactly the same interests that I've been talking about here. They're concerned about the shortage on the river. They're concerned about shortages in the CAP because that's their lifeline. And I think one of the reasons we can be somewhat, I wouldn't be very optimistic, but somewhat optimistic about the federal government never taking us to zero is they have obligations to the Gila River Indian Community and the other 11 tribes that are 10 tribes that we serve. Colorado Indian tribe is different. They're on the river. They're at Parker. So they're not taking water from the CAP. They are taking it directly from the river. And they have rights. Their rights go back to 1868. So when we talk about prior appropriation, there aren't any, or there are very few, that are older than theirs. It's a small community. They've really rallied about water conservation. They've done a much better job than they used to in terms of their farming. But the rights that the federal government gave them, Congress gave them recently, was that 200,000 acre feet could be sent to other destinations in Arizona. Previously, it had to be used on the land of the tribe. So that's why the legislation was so important. And I think in all likelihood, that 200,000 will end up coming through the CAP to users in Central Arizona. It has to be a user within the state. It has to be a government user. It has to be either the Central Arizona Project itself or the cities in Central Arizona. Those are the most likely candidates for that supply. It hasn't been firmed up yet, by the way. They still have a whole question of beneficial use, return flow, and efficient use of the water that has to be resolved before the contracts are signed. But it's imminent, and I think it is an important part of our water future.
Thank you very much for a really informative presentation. I learned a lot this morning. As a recovering economist, I'm used to thinking about the role of price whenever we talk about scarce resources. I've lived in Europe where water's expensive. We take showers very differently there. We don't leave the water running. We get wet, we soap up, we wash it off, and so forth. So price can definitely change behavior. I'm curious, could you talk a little bit about the role of price as a solution here to deal with this problem in the future?
Another hour, please. I basically agree with it that we're moving slowly and toward a more market-driven water economy, but we're not there. We're not even close. Right now, for instance, the water in the Central Arizona Project is free. We don't pay anything for the water, and neither do any of our customers. They pay for the cost of pumping, and they pay for basically the amortization of the cost of building the canal. So right now we provide water to our customers at about $300 an acre foot. In the context of what is that water worth, that's chump change. That water is worth a great deal more than that in terms of both, maybe not so much agriculture, because agriculture says they can't pay over $300. But, and the folks that are on the river don't have the delivery charges, so their water is even cheaper. Well, I said our groundwater situation was a fool's paradise. Let me perhaps add this one to the equation, because water is, as the Navajos say, and I think most Native Americans do, water is life. It is the key ingredient. We don't survive without it. And it also drives our economy, and it drives, you know, the quality of living in this area. So let's think very seriously about what worth do we put on life? Because I think that ultimately is the question. And we haven't done a very good job of analyzing that. For instance, there are crops in the Yuma Valley. By the way, if you're not familiar with Yuma agriculture, that would be an interesting sidelight to look at, because they are as efficient as any on the planet. They use laser leveling to the nth degree. I mean, those fields are not an inch out of line. They forecrop the area of the Yuma Valley, and I've seen them where the one crop is taken out in the morning, and they set up and feed the new one in the afternoon, literally that fast. It is incredibly productive. That land, that water is producing food. It's producing the entire winter salad production for the United States. It's incredible. Now, all agriculture isn't that efficient. There's areas even in Yuma that grow dates and grow alfalfa and grow other cotton, other things that are not quite as equivalent to life. So I can see a very strong argument to keep the Yuma operation going for many reasons, but one of them is we need the food, we need the fiber. But that doesn't apply to every bit of agriculture in Arizona. So let's look at the ones where the marginal efficiency, I hope I'm using an economic term efficiently, the marginal production of a gallon or an acre foot of water is tremendously varied. And I think to be realistic, we need to say, well, the lower marginal production could be used for something else. The higher marginal probably is right where it belongs. So that's the kind of discussion we need to have. We're not having it yet.
In the last several days, we've had a lot of rain here. Are you able to save that water, or does it all get wasted?
Well, let me start with the word waste. Water isn't wasted. The fact that it goes down the Salt River means that it's recharging a groundwater supply somewhere along the river. But it's not controlled. In other words, we're not using it, so I know how you used it, but I just wanted to start with that one. In the last year, you know, I flew the Gila River Valley back in April, and it was amazing. You know, as a lifelong Arizonan, I was really inspired. Everything was blooming. It was just an incredible year. Lake Roosevelt It was as full as it could be. There's an interesting standard that basically says after Roosevelt was raised, it has 1 million acre feet of storage capacity that is basically reserved for floods. So when it comes into Lake Roosevelt, Salt River has to let it go, I think in a period of about 60 days, but it may be even less than that. So they can't retain it because you need to keep that capacity in case something even bigger should happen to come in the watershed. You don't want to have the dam overtopped. They're working to have that standard changed so that they can keep some more storage behind Roosevelt, and we're very supportive of that idea. The biggest one that would deal with your question is the interconnect between the Central Arizona Project and Salt River Project. Right now, you can use Colorado River water in the Salt River system, but you can't do the opposite. You can't move the Salt and the Verde water into the CAP. If you could have done that in this last season, there was between 300,000 and 400,000 acre feet that could have been picked up at Granite Reef and moved into the CAP, and then we would have taken less water out of the Colorado. So it would have been the bank would have been replenished that way, and we would have all been, I think, significantly better off. So that's in the drawing boards for one of the ways that we're going to try to deal with this water crisis, is that interconnect. We're also talking about raising Bartlett Dam on the Verde so that it would provide another 100,000 acre feet of storage that it doesn't do today. So it would help to catch it. But let me talk, all of us, I think, and we haven't taken this very seriously in Central Arizona. Tucson's a lot better at it. But we can store water on our individual houses. That I know there's a mosquito issue that we have to be careful about. There are lots of things that the sanitation people are worried. But we do a terrible job of doing what other communities, other civilizations do much better, which is a certain amount of domestic storage. I'm just working on a project in downtown Phoenix, which is restoring an old church. And we put a fairly significant water storage system underground so that if we have, as we will have, things to grow ornamental things to grow in the around the building, that it will have a water supply when it does rain that we can use, and we won't be taking it off the general. We need to do a better job of conservation, and that's part of the way to do it. It's called gray water. It's somewhat controversial, but it's long past time that we need to look at it seriously.
Yes. Having been in the water business for
You're the
years.
Expert. I shouldn't be talking.
Well, here's a point. You mentioned desalination, which I know a lot about, and you kind of put it at the bottom of the list. But if the climate scientists are right, and I'm talking not near term, 10 years, but over the next 50 years, what other choice do we have besides seawater desalination? I mean, as I recall, didn't IDEC, the Israeli firm, propose a system from Baja that actually we wouldn't have to put up any money and they would just charge us per acre foot of what's produced, just like they do in the Mideast. So I guess what I'm saying is shouldn't desalination at least be on the table for the longer run? Because I don't see any other choice if it goes on like they say it will for the next 50 years.
I wouldn't disagree that, and hopefully technology will meet us in the middle so that we would have more efficient ways of taking the salt out of the water. But we do have other sources, and it seems to me you don't jump right to the most expensive one. There are, brackish water, something I know a lot more than I do about, that can be treated and made potable much easier than salt water. The reclamation of the sewage supply is something that I think is already on the table and needs to be thoroughly examined now that the feds have some money. Hopefully that's one of the ways they will spend it. I put this slide back because I think it's important that we in Arizona think about all of our water sources. And that doesn't mean you stop agriculture in Central Arizona, but it does mean I think you've cast a critical eye on what is the longest, highest and best use for each of those gallons. And I don't think many people would feel that alfalfa is in that category. Now, I could be wrong, but it's been a long time since I've eaten alfalfa. I know that cows do, and they like it. It's very nutritious, but it also uses 7 to 8 acre feet per acre of alfalfa, and that's a lot of water. So keep it on the table for sure. I mean, we have to continue, and we are at CAP. We've got an active research program going on the all the different Mexican sites and what the various needs would be if they went forward. The Israeli program, there's a little hook there. They're not putting the money up. We are. And we would have to have long-term contracts at a fixed price before they would start construction. So unless we're willing to say, yep, we'll pay for the next 100 years, we're going to pay $3,000 an acre foot or more, they're not going to go forward.
What role, if anything, does the SRP canal system and flood irrigation play in this overall picture?
Well, those are two separate topics, I hope. SRP is an amazing system. I mean, I think we are the beneficiaries of the long-term views of the people who settled this area in the late 1800s, who literally mortgaged their farms and ranches to build Roosevelt Dam and the system that comes in. It was, as I'm sure you know, it originally was a system of canals pioneered by the Hohokam, who had this whole area of the Salt River Valley heavily irrigated through canal systems in the 1000s and 1200s. And so the early settlers just carved out those canals, and Salt River has been the ultimate user and perfecter of the system. So most of what we have in central Arizona is part of the foresight of those people. But it isn't universal. It doesn't cover the entire geographical area. So that's where the CAP filled in a very important important gap in the Arizona water picture. Flood irrigation is perhaps the least efficient way to grow crops. It is the most prevalent by far. Much of the irrigation in central Arizona, on the river, is still flood irrigation. We're working with those farmers. We have an Israeli company called Endrip, which is now headquartered in Phoenix. And at CAP, we've been negotiating with them working with them for pilot projects on a lot of farming operations in western Maricopa County, on the Crit, Indian area, and even in Yuma, to provide gravity flow drip irrigation directly to the crops. At its very best, it's about a 50% reduction in water use for the same production over flood irrigation. Now, you can, figures don't lie, but liars figure, how do you have it? But there are lots of subtleties in that agricultural picture. So some flood irrigation is more efficient than others. But bottom line, that's still what a very significant proportion of Arizona agriculture uses. And there's some big savings from working with those farmers to find more efficient ways to grow the same crops. And we're trying to do that, because that's another way to capture some of the excess ag water for use in the cities. It's going to cost a lot of money, but we could do that.
Incentive to the farmer to transfer their water? Okay. What is the incentive to farmers to get them to start using drip irrigation? Who pays for the equipment? Who pays for the transfer over to a totally new system? How do you change the thinking process?
Well, it's part of the value of water. What we're talking about at CAP and what is being aggressively looked at the Bureau of Reclamation is providing very heavy government subsidies to provide the change, to be able to, in exchange for that, the water that's saved would be considered in the public domain. In other words, it's another way of calculating the cost per acre foot. In other words, if the cost per acre foot is I spend $100 or $150 an acre to put drip irrigation in what was previously flood irrigated, and it is a 50% savings, then I think for that investment I should get the 50% savings, maybe to bring into central Arizona. That's what we at CAP are thinking at very aggressively. So it's not the farmer is just not in the business of growing crops entirely, it seems to me, in the future. Many of them have senior water rights, which are respected, but also need to be monetized.
Do we know the impact of flood irrigation on recharge of groundwater supplies?
Well, I'm sure you know it's called return flow, and the farmers get credit for the recharge that is produced if they're in the AMA from their water. If you're on the Colorado River and you take advantage of the water and part of it goes back into the river, obviously that's subtracted from your total take. So that's a return flow issue. There's kind of in the same ballpark. One's surface water, the other's groundwater, so it gets complicated. But yes, there is a recharge benefit from farming. Now, there's also a purity problem there, because much of the water, after it's gone through the farm several times, very high in salts, fairly high in fertilizer. Sir?
I'm from Atlanta, and we pay a lot more on a monthly basis for our water. When we came here, we were amazed at how much we pay, and you've explained that why that's true, but I don't understand why we're not being charged for the water we use.
Well, let's go back to the economic question. What is the actual value of the water? And so far, we're not really putting that in the equation. And I think one of the sort of important parts of the discussion today is that needs to happen. And at one point, and this goes prior to the Gallego administration and after mine, Phoenix on its, you know, wait on hold, and people, unfortunately, who call the water department often spend a lot of time on that very agreeable recording. It used to say that Phoenix is the largest city in the, of the large cities in the country, Phoenix has the lowest water rates. And I remember calling outraged, saying, I hope that's not true, and if it is, you shouldn't talk about it. But the cost of water still is the cost of delivery. And it's not the value of the water itself. Now that, I think, has to change.
Maybe do two more questions here.
Thank you, this was very informative, but I don't wanna leave without a task. So in addition to paying attention to the upcoming election for the board, what other thing might I do to move forward some of the projects that you talked about that would make a significant difference for our children and grandchildren?
Well, thank you for that question. I hope you will urge your legislators to sort of get moving on things like better groundwater management. That's something that they've kicked off every year and haven't seriously addressed. And that's a problem. They're okay with dealing with the Saudi issue because that suddenly hit the headlines. But the real Saudi issue is the failure to have groundwater controls throughout the state. It's not the Saudis. It's the fact that the whole system needs repair. And just talking about it, I mean, I think many people, because water is complicated and there aren't really a lot of clean or easy fixes, just gets, you know, turn on the tap, if it runs, fine, we're good. On the other hand, there are people who do the Chicken Little approach and say, the sky is falling, I have to move. A friend of mine just moved to Washington, and this was one of the reasons. I don't believe you have a water supply. I hope I've given you concern, but not panic. The water supply is manageable. We have to do a better job of it. That means supporting Mayor Gallego on her efforts to do very significant increases in water purification that comes into the sewage system. We need to do a better water job, as the point was made earlier about rainwater that runs through our streets. That's, if it's not wasted, it's certainly not being used to its highest use. And so let's work on that as individuals and as communities. And I wish I had a single client to say, yeah, go out and support X. It is a multifaceted issue and needs to be dealt with in a lot of different ways. But I guess the first thing and the most important for you and your grandchildren is let's be aware. Let's be water wise, to use the CAP slogan. It is an important part of our environment. It is a manageable part of environment. The idea that it is without cost and infinite is wrong, and we need to get rid of that idea. We're in a desert. We live in an arid environment. We need to be real about it. And that's just not the equation that you see. It's moving. It's getting better. But we are in a time of increased dryness, increased lower rainfall, higher temperatures. That requires a lot of intelligence all across the board that we're just, and so don't run the water while you're brushing your teeth. There's some simple things we can do that do make it better. And that's an ethic that other countries have certainly adopted. We've been very slow. We're in denial.
Hi. You've mentioned several times about the cost of our water being the cost of delivery. And I guess my question is the evaporative loss in the open canal system of any significance? And if it is there an engineering solution to mitigate that in our arid environment?
Well, I don't want to give the totally political answer, but the answer is we're looking into it. There are a couple of pilot projects here in Maricopa County that we're going to watch very carefully. One is Salt River Project. It's got a couple of canal stretches that they're going to put solar over the canals and see what the difference is. Gila River Indian Community is another that now has a federal grant to put solar over their canals. Our cautions are these. Of the 1.5 million acre feet that are delivered each year until the cutbacks under Tier 1, the overwhelming majority of the losses were from the lakes, was not from the canals. So the total canal loss is not insignificant. It's in the like 10,000 acre feet. That's a lot of water. But it is a fraction of what we're delivering. And the cost of covering is very high, not just in the actual cost of putting this fifth system in place, but the trade-off. We empty the canals and service them twice a year, well, once a year. How do you do that if you've got a construct over the canal? You can't. What is the distribution? Solar is the remedy, but we have 336 miles of canal. You can't have an efficient solar grid over the long, skinny. If you look at solar grids around the country, they're in compressed areas. There's a reason for that. They're usually near the demand, and they have limited capacity for transmission. Our canal would need incredible transmission. And the last part is solar market is very strange. If you haven't been studying it, we have what we call the duck curve, which means that around 4 o'clock in the afternoon, power is essentially free because there is so much solar coming into the market. And we've done a great job, I think, at CAP buying into the duck curve. We turn off our pumps in periods when cost is high, and we really operate them when the solar is hitting the market at its maximum. But then it goes away, and that's the problem of the evenings. So we try not to pump in those periods, and that's just smart power management. But the fact that we don't need more solar power right now on the grid is another part of our equation. So it's complicated. Does it stop evaporation? We're studying that. Does it provide a meaningful source of income? We're studying that, but we don't think so. And is it going to completely interrupt our maintenance and operations? Probably. So those are all things that are not readily apparent, but we're taking it seriously. I mean, if it would stop evaporation in a significant way, then we ought to be looking at it, and we are. Okay, I think that's the last question. If I counted the number right, I know I've gone over my time, for which I apologize, Jim. I tried to keep it. Thank you very much.